I'll begin with some prayers and then I'll discuss with the PowerPoint something about Maharaj. Om Gyanatimirandasya Gyananjanishalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Namah Om Vishnupadaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Iti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve गौरवाणी प्रचारणे निर्विशेषशून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्यैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधार श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा। सो
हरे कृष्णा प्रभु। हरि बोल।
ग्रेटफुल टू बी हियर विद ऑल ऑफ यू टुडे एंड दिस हैज बीन अ वेरी रिलिशेबल टाइम फॉर मी आल्सो हियरिंग अबाउट Prabhu, can I record on my end also if possible? Can you give me the permission to record?
Yes, Prabhu, I'm making you the co-host, Prabhu.
Okay. You know, I cannot record because already recording. So I'll stop the recording, start on the laptop, and then you can start on the cloud once again. Is that okay?
Yes, Prabhu.
Okay. Thank you. So when I hear the devotional offerings of many of my senior god brothers who have had far more association, god brothers, even god sisters who have had far more association of Maharaj than what I have, I sometimes feel like what Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur has said about licking a bottle of honey from outside. So I am more of an analytical person, and I have had a few very meaningful and deep interactions with Maharaj. But I've also, you could say, from an analytical perspective, try to understand how our movement has progressed, and especially in Mumbai area, and then as I've traveled across the world, other places. And at one time, I was also asked to write a book on ISKCON history, especially ISKCON's post-Prabhupada history. But it was a very complicated project and quite a controversial project, so I did not do that, but I did study quite a bit. So in one sense, today what I'll speak about is how Maharaj has carried on Prabhupada's legacy. And while Maharaj has done many, many things in Prabhupada's movement, I will focus on one particular thing, that is community building. And of course, we could say the major community he has built is in Radha Gopinath Temple. But along with that, I would say that inspired by Maharaj's vision, inspired by not just our God family, but by those who are inspired by Maharaj in general, the vision for community building has spread across the movement. And in one sense, now we may think that because when we become practice bhakti, we naturally become a part of a community. So we say, what is so special about it? But actually, if we look at the overall history of ISKCON, things were quite different. You see, the idea of a community as we understand it today was not really there in ISKCON's history. Because in the past, joining ISKCON meant moving into the temple. So the community was about full-time devotees. But now most devotees are not full-time devotees. And then we have to actually re-envision what community means. And not just re-envision it, but then actually manifest that vision into reality. So I'll talk about how Maharaj has done so. And I'll talk about what I'm going to present today is from three perspectives. From my overall understanding of our movement's history, from my interactions with leaders of the Radha Gopinath community, and also some of my very, as I said, meaningful interactions with Maharaj also. So let's begin this. So the Maharaj, time and time again, he's emphasized that whatever he is doing is for pleasing Srila Prabhupada. In fact, Maharaj, for one thing, he had no desire at all to have any disciples. His accepting disciples was also his service to Prabhupada because of the upheavals in New Vrindavan. And many devotees whom Maharaj had cared for, they were left without their spiritual master. So from that time onwards, so Maharaj has taken up this service. So even his building of a community is at least from what I've understood, Maharaj considers that his most important offering to Prabhupada. Generally, Maharaj is not in Radha Gopinath temple during Janmashtami time. He's usually in London or somewhere else. But one or two years he has been there. And on both these occasions, after Janmashtami, when there is the Prabhupada appearance day celebration, at that time Maharaj said that, what is our offering to Prabhupada? He said, is this a beautiful temple? He said, it's not just a temple, it is all of you. It is this community that is our offering to Prabhupada. And he also stresses that actually it is Prabhupada's mercy that he has enabled us to do this offering. But in Maharaj's own, if you look at broad ISKCON history, what Maharaj has done, and from Maharaj's own personal words, so the garland that he's offering to Prabhupada is of course, he offered many flower garlands to Prabhupada, but the garland that he's offered specially is the garlands of the community that he has built, and further the community that he's inspired to build. So now, what are the challenges for building a community? So first of all, there were no immediate precedents. Generally, whenever we want to do anything, we look at what our acharya has done and what has been done in the Shastra. So why were there no immediate precedents? Because Prabhupada was with us for too short a time after ISKCON was established. Prabhupada was there barely for 10 years or so. And 11 years, you could actually, 11 years from 66 to 77. But then as the movement started expanding, he needed to travel a lot across the world. And then further, he not only had to travel, he couldn't stay at any one place to systematically develop a community over there. So the nearest we have example, we could say three examples. One is Prabhupada in the early days, first in New York, and second in, and after that in San Francisco. He interacted very closely with devotees at that time in Lower East Side in Haight-Ashbury. But in both places, the dynamics were very different. As I said, whoever joined the movement was living in the temple. It was very small, and there were no, it is almost anybody who came was a full-time devotee. So many of the dynamics of a community as we have it today, they were not there at all. That there are different ashramas and there are different responsibilities and different expectations and different concerns in different ashrams. And most devotees are also far more a part of the world than they were at that time. So another could be that Prabhupada considered eventually LA to be his Western headquarters. And he did write a lot of letters about how LA, things should be set up in LA. But even that focus was more on how to standardize the deity worship over there. And then how that could become like a model for deity worship for the rest of ISKCON. It was not, if you look at the letters that Srila Prabhupada wrote, he does talk about devotees naturally, but it is not so much about community building that much. And we may say Prabhupada spent a lot of time in India. He spent a lot of time in Mumbai. Mumbai is the time he spent the most time. Mumbai is a place where he spent the most time after he started ISKCON. But even in Mumbai, actually, for most of the time when Srila Prabhupada was here, there were not many Indians who became devotees. Many Indians were very great well-wishers. They became life members. They supported Prabhupada in the fight for the Juhu temple. But in one sense, all these life members were already parts of their own communities. They were established in business. They had their families. And they never, in a sense, became a part of the ISKCON community. They were very dedicated to the ISKCON in their own way. And the devotee, those who were devotees, were mostly devotees from the West who were living more in a missionary mode. So in that sense, there were no immediate precedents about how to build a community. And when, if we see after, during the time of Prabhupada's later years and immediately after him, after his departure, there were two broad demographics, two broad groups of people that Prabhupada had cultivated. They're full-time devotees in the West and they were life members in India. Now you can call these as two different demographics, but at the same time, in terms of levels of spiritual commitment, there was a huge difference. The full-time devotees had practically given up the entire world to take up Krishna consciousness. And the life members, they were very much a part of the world. And they were, their main contribution was giving donations. Another contribution was they had some contacts, some connections by which they got things done. And they assisted Prabhupada in invaluable ways, in ways that his disciples could not have accomplished in India on their own. So now if you consider this, why am I using the word yawning gap over here? There's a huge gap between these two demographics, the full-time devotees and the life members. And in one sense, the way our movement has changed is that almost both these demographics have decreased substantially. Although life membership cultivation is still happening to some extent in India, but that has gone down substantially. And if we consider the number of full-time devotees, that also has decreased substantially. During Prabhupada's time, it was like 90 to 95% of devotees were full-time devotees. Now in today's world, 90 to 95% of, even if you say 97% of devotees are not temple residents. Now, of course, we could expand the definition of full-time and say that every devotee is a full-time devotee because we want to offer our whole life to Krishna. And that is our aspiration for everyone. But I'm talking more in terms of full-time, in terms of residing in the temple and practicing, and their whole life is centered on the temple. So now, if we consider, now why is this important? If we see Maharaj's own example of his life, see, first, he went on his search for God. His search culminated in finding Krishna and Prabhupada Vrindavan. And then he came and stayed in New Vrindavan. So New Vrindavan, you could say, was not just an example of full-time devotees in a temple, but it is isolated from the world completely. It is completely isolated from the world. And that's how he lived for years there, several years. And even in that community, Maharaj was somewhat isolated because he was on top of a hill doing pujari worship. And then after that, he was told to do college preaching. Even while doing college preaching, it was, if we hear of Maharaj's life at that time, he was mostly traveling and he had his own van, and he would go from college to college and preach and try to cultivate people. But he was traveling so much that it was cultivating devotees, but not exactly cultivating a community. And yes, some people would join, and a few came to New Vrindavan. But New Vrindavan by that time had also become quite turbulent. So now, before actually Maharaj could reap fully the fruits of his college preaching, he worked hard and many people became devotees. But before those people could assist him, before those people became mature enough to assist him in dramatically expanding his college preaching, he was sent to India. Now, there could be various reasons and we won't get into the history. But when he came to India, it was, in one sense, a completely different dynamic. Because in India, there already, even at that time, in 1986-87 onwards, there were already a good number of devotees who were coming, and more started coming. But the Indian dynamic was very different. So as today's ISKCON, as I said, most members are not living in the temple. But although they're not living in the temple, the key point is that today most devotees, when we call somebody as ISKCON member, of course, there is this thing, quite, you could say, at one level funny, at one level very liberating, that there is no definition of an ISKCON member. Now, do you define an ISKCON member by saying that person is an initiated devotee? Well, okay. But then many initiated devotees sometimes struggle to follow the standards. Sometimes people take initiation and then stop practicing bhakti also. And some devotees may be waiting for initiation for a decade. And they are far more serious than many initiated devotees also. So how do we actually define a member? So let's not get into that discussion. Broadly speaking, we can say that somebody who has accepted the sadhana and sadhya that Prabhupada has given. The sadhya is that Krishna is God, and sadhya is that we practice bhakti centered on chanting of the holy names. So if we consider that, then there are a lot of devotees. And so most of ISKCON's demographic today exists between the full-time devotees and the life members. They're not full-time devotees, but the life members, they didn't do sadhana. They were not sadhakas. They were bhaktas, but not sadhakas. They had some devotion from their cultural upbringing, from their family heritage, whatever it was, from their past lives, piety, whatever it could be. But they were not, most of them were not really practicing serious sadhana. Whereas Prabhupada wanted us to practice serious sadhana. So we say most devotees today are at a level of dedication far higher than the life members. And they may be as dedicated life as full-time devotees living in the temple also. But they're not living in the temple. So their life has many other dimensions. So this itself was a big challenge for our movement in general. And how big this challenge was, to understand this, I was talking with Ravindra Swarup Prabhu, and he told me that when for many decades, he was looking after the Philadelphia temple. So he said that initially our vision of preaching was that, okay, people come to Sunday program or other programs, and we preach to them and they move into the temple. And he found that at that time, many Indians would started coming to our temples, but these Indians had no intention of moving to the temple. So what happened after some time, they would come to the temple, but we thought they are never going to become devotees. And we stopped paying attention to them. We just neglected them. And then we started looking, who else is coming? Who will move into the temple? And so over a period of months and years, we noticed that. And although we didn't pay any attention to these Indians, they just kept coming. They kept coming. And he said at that time, it would be so funny if these mostly Indian people, but others were also there to some extent. If somebody had asked these Indians, which religious group do you belong to? They would say, we are Hare Krishnas. But if somebody had asked us, are they Hare Krishnas? No, they are not Hare Krishnas, because they are not coming to the temple. They are not moving into the temple. So that self-definition was a problem. But in many ways, it was in the 1980s, the whole idea of a congregation program. Congregation program means that you go to the house of congregation and do regular programs, maybe once a week, once a fortnight program. That started in the 1980s. Before that, the idea was you distribute books, you meet people, and then if they are inspired, they come to the temple. That people can stay in their homes and practice bhakti. That conception was not there so much. So when Maharaj came to India, what he did at those days was, I was just talking with Krishna Chandra Prabhu, telling that from 1985, 86 till 1992, 93, almost every evening Maharaj would have a program. And Krishna Chandra Prabhu would every day drive him. Every evening. And initially maybe 20, 25, 30 people would come. Maybe eventually numbers started increasing. But his idea of going to devotees' houses and doing program and spending time with them at an individual level. So that is what Maharaj encouraged. And Maharaj, so I was talking here about what happened with we had the full-time model, we had the life membership model. But most of our ISKCON is this model. So I'm talking about how Maharaj, for building the community, focused on this demographic of the congregation members. So now the problem with the full-time model is that most devotees couldn't continue full-time lifelong. And that is just natural. If you look at even Vedic times, most of the sages were grihasthas. So renouncing the world itself is not easy, and renouncing the world and staying in the world is much more difficult. And that is what is required of preachers in ISKCON. So that's entirely understandable. So what happened was, also The full-time model didn't work because not many devotees stayed full-time, and communities also no longer temple-based. They were spread around the temple quite widely. But the life membership model also, it had a limitation. Prabhupada's hope was that the life members, they would come to the temples. They had this facility to stay 3 days in the temple, and they would see the morning program. They would see the deities. They would see the dedication of the devotees, and they would become devotees. Somehow that didn't happen. Even the life members who came and stayed, for them, it was more of, okay, they were going on tourism to some place and they wanted to see that place, and ISKCON temple just became like a hotel for them to stay. So they liked it, but most of them, very few of the life members actually went on to become devotees. I'm not saying that it didn't work. At that time, it did help Prabhupada establish temples in India, and it made a lot of well-wishers. So Srila Prabhupada's disciple was telling me that he had gone to at that time, some interior city in India. It was maybe, there were not many devotees over there, something like Indore or Bhopal or something like that. And he went to one well-to-do person's house, and he saw that person had actually put on his nameplate, his degree. And he had put in his degree, BA, LLB, this, that, and below that, ISKCON life member. So he had put that as his degree. So what had happened was, they said, Prabhupada had made it in such a way that, oh, ISKCON is an international organization, and it's a prestigious thing that you can be a life member. So in that sense, it was successful. But in terms of making those life members into devotees, that didn't happen. So now, what was Maharaj's challenge? As I mentioned that, he was moved suddenly from a secluded temple worship and then traveling college outreach to handling the diverse needs of an entire community in India. A lot of devotees coming, many of them were in India, the family structure is quite still strong. And so at that time, when I was in Chicago, I was talking with Maharaj. So Maharaj mentioned that the first few months and years when I was in India, I was trying to get my hands on everything that Prabhupada had spoken or done in India. That means, how did Prabhupada interact with life members? How did Prabhupada interact with Indians? What did he speak in his classes to Indians? Because India was a completely different, you could say, ball game. So just as when we meaning the Indian preachers, Indian brahmacharis come to the West, and if we want to reach out to Western audiences, we have to learn, it's a different ball game. So in one sense, for Maharaj, when he came to India, he had, how do we go about preaching over here? So Maharaj said that, I read everything, heard, whatever I could about how was Prabhupada interacting with people in India. Because, you see, this is a big subject. At one level, Prabhupada was very successful in his strategy of getting Western people to come to India. And then that inspired Indians. But the inspiration that came from that was more of an inspiration of cultural nationalism. It was not bhakti spirituality. That means our culture is so great that the Western people are also adopting it. But does that mean we have to adopt it exactly the way they are doing it? Not really. So that came later. The serious people becoming devotees in a serious way in India started happening in the mid 80s, you can say. So now I'll talk about 3-4 things that Maharaj did. So this is again my observation, my interaction with Maharaj, and my interaction with God brother, with other God family. So if we consider Maharaj's classes, Maharaj's emphasis, there's a small but significant shift. So Maharaj, in his classes, he focused on service attitude, not on renunciation. If we look at Prabhupada's lectures, Prabhupada is quite strong in condemning sense gratification. Dukkha yona yevate, how it will cause entanglement, how it will cause suffering. And that was important because Prabhupada's followers were living in a culture which is completely steeped in all forms of sense gratification. So that is important. And Maharaj also quotes those verses. But if we comparatively speak, Maharaj's focus is much more on service attitude, not so much on renunciation. So Maharaj's most quoted verses, which if you ask any disciple, they heard a few classes, they'll know is Trunada Pismani Chena. So now, what does this shift mean? If we shift from renunciation to service attitude, what this is a in the study of religion, this is called as creative theologizing. Theology is the study of God, study of religion. Creative theologizing means that the knowledge about God is presented in a way that addresses the needs of the current audience, of the audience of that generation. So now what happens when there is a overemphasis on detachment? It leads to, if there's too much detachment, don't be attached. It leads to cold-heartedness toward people in general and even toward other devotees. So if for example, some devotee doesn't follow proper standards, or what I think is a proper standard somebody is not following, if I focus on detachment, I just cut myself off from that devotee. I have got nothing to do with that devotee. So it leads to cold-heartedness. It leads to lack of proper relationships. And then this can lead even to relationship conflicts. If there is overemphasis on renunciation, then the renounced order thinks that we are already liberated. And household order thinks that, oh, we are fallen and we are bound and there is very little hope for us. So that leads to a kind of superiority complex among the renounced order. That leads to inferiority complex among the householders. And eventually that leads to inter-ashram conflicts. This happened, we know, in Prabhupada's time, also in 1976, when, let's not go into the history, but this has happened and this keeps happening. So when there is overemphasis on renunciation, it can very easily lead to a fault-finding mentality. The renounced order may say, oh, you are not renounced, to the householders. And the householders may say, okay, you are in the renounced order, but are you actually being renounced? Oh, you do like this, you do like that. So an overemphasis on renunciation can actually create tensions and conflicts. It leads, first of all, to cold-heartedness. And cold-heartedness is not very conducive for building a community. I remember one of the senior devotees in our movement. He is very senior. He just being initiated by Prabhupada by just a year or so. So he told me he heard Maharaj's lecture first time in 89-90. And Maharaj said that, you know, we all should serve each other and there should be love and trust among devotees. And he says, remembers, when I first heard this, he said, I look at the devotee sitting next to me. He says, love and trust among devotees. Is that ISKCON philosophy? Is that ISKCON philosophy, that love and trust among devotees? He thought ISKCON philosophy is be detached. So it was, for us, it seems common sense because we have heard it so many times, but it is a very significant shift in focus. So what happens is, when there is service attitude, then, okay, whatever position a particular person is in, what happens is that there is, okay, this person is a Vaishnava, I should serve this person. And then when we serve each other, we care for each other, that naturally develops affection, and we can count on this person. Oh, if I need some trouble, this person will be there. So love and trust develop by that. So love and trust don't develop by detachment alone. Of course, there has to be some basic level of detachment. There is attachment also. If there's too much attachment also, you cannot trust such a person, because for their attachment, they will do anything. But if there's overemphasis on attachment, there is a problem. And then on top of that, if there is too much emphasis on attachment, it leads to guilt, because one is not able to live up to the standard that is expected. And then one starts feeling lonely because one cannot even tell one's problems to others. What will others think of me? And then it leads to all kinds of psychological problems. So, and it becomes worse if one is publicly preaching, oh, you should give up zero sense gratification, this, that, that. And then one is not able to practice that. So what happens is, in general, Maharaj's focus has not been on detachment. He personally exemplifies detachment, and he does encourage, in one sense, exemplary behavior from all his disciples. But I remember once a senior godbrother asked Maharaj a question that, you know, if a devotee who we had recommended for initiation, or that person stops following the standards or does something sinful, will we get the karma for that? So Maharaj said that, he says, don't think about karma at all. At that time, think only about how that devotee can be assisted in being elevated. So he says, yes, sometimes devotees may do something wrong, but the important thing is that always devotees should be encouraged to practice bhakti. Even if you chastise someone for doing something wrong, at the end of that interaction, that devotee should feel encouraged to practice bhakti. The devotee should never feel abandoned or rejected. And that abandonment, rejectment is what often happens when we overemphasize detachment. So Maharaj said, don't even think about karma at that time. I remember that sentence very strongly. Now what happens is, when there is an emphasis on service attitude instead of renunciation, what happens by this? It fosters respect for everyone as parts of Krishna. Okay, whether somebody is great ako, vane ako, that doesn't matter. Naham vipronacha garpatir, napi vaishyona shudro. Now, when I say this is, when Maharaj did that shift, that doesn't mean that shift is to something new. It is very much there in our tradition. Mahaprabhu respected everyone, his grihastha disciples as well as his non-sorta disciples. But that shift Maharaj brought, because that was not there prominent in our teaching at that time. So if we see everyone as a part of Krishna, then we see by serving everyone, we can gain mercy. We can grow spiritually. So if you see one of the consistent emphasis of Maharaj's, come together in association of devotees, hear about Krishna and serve in the mood of a servant. So this actually helps connect with each other much more. And then the key thing is, it's not that detachment is not emphasized, but we could say service attitude is actually the means to get the higher taste by which detachment will come. Just emphasizing detachment doesn't automatically produce detachment. Rather, when we do seva, that seva pleases Krishna, that seva pleases Vaishnava, that seva pleases Guru. And even more, don't just do seva, if we have seva bhav, that pleases even more. And when that happens, then naturally we all get higher taste. So in that sense, service attitude is the means to develop detachment. Of course, we could say at one level, detachment is the incidental byproduct of service attitude. The real fruit of service attitude is attachment to Krishna. So then also what happens is that when there's a focus on service attitude, it assures everyone that there is space for them within the movement. Even if they fall short of certain predefined standards of renunciation. Oh, you know, I couldn't do this. I couldn't do this. I couldn't do this. So what happens over here is, otherwise, for devotees, often it's like 1-0. If I'm following the standards, then I'm in the movement. If I can't follow the standards, and especially it becomes known to people I can't follow the standards, then it'll be so humiliating, I can't stay in this movement at all. So I have to leave. So I remember there was one senior devotee here in the Radha Gopinath community who had some difficulties. And then there were many issues with him. But then he was told for some time to not come to the temple. And he was quite well known to other devotees. So then Maharaj called several of his senior disciples. He told them that, you know, at an administrative level, this decision may have had to be taken. But at a personal level, maintain your relationship with him. Maintain your relationship with him. And encourage him. And engage him in whatever you can. And Maharaj talked about Kala Krishna Das. When Mahaprabhu rejected him, but the Vaishnavas engaged him. The Vaishnavas told him that, okay, you can go to Kala Krishna Das. Had traveled with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu on his tours. But unfortunately, at that time, he had been temporarily lured by the Bhattaharis. And Mahaprabhu was upset by that. But the devotees engaged him. The devotees told him, you go to, from Puri, you go to Mayapur, and you tell the Mayapur devotees about the pastimes of Lord Chaitanya, what will happen in South India. And when he went there, what happened was, there the devotees welcomed him because he was simply going to speak about Mahaprabhu. And then he felt accepted, he felt valued. And in that way, the devotees engaged him. So Maharaj quoted that pastime and he said that, yes, sometimes even if somebody, it's not just detachment, even if somebody has some problem in following certain moral standards, basic moral standards also, if there is a service attitude, okay, this person did something wrong, but still, how can we serve? If detachment only becomes the sole filter through which we look at the world, then that creates a lot of problems. But service attitude is the filter or the lens through which we are looking at the world. Then there is space for everyone. Even if they are not practicing bhakti very seriously according to particular standards of seriousness. Now, another very significant thing that Maharaj did, we could go into a lot into it. See, Maharaj doesn't so much emphasize preaching in the sense of go out and distribute books, cultivate, he doesn't emphasize on preaching. But what he says is that, this is one of his, another very important quote, a happy devotee is the best preacher. So what he said is that, yes, we can tell the world, oh, bhakti is so wonderful, practice bhakti. But that will not have as much effect on people in inspiring them as by showing them how wonderful bhakti is. And how do we show it? Through our personal walk, through our joy. If we are happy, if we are well connected in the community and people feel a welcoming mood in the community, then naturally there'll be outreach, there'll be expansion. So expansion doesn't have to happen by simply, again, emphasizing preach. It happens by, Prabhupada has talked about preaching. And yes, we will see Maharaj's example also. That he is traveling. He could have rested on his laurels in India. He had worked hard, built a wonderful community, and he could have stayed over there. But Maharaj chose to come to the West and try to do Western outreach. So Maharaj's example is there personally. But how does preaching happen most effectively? If devotees are happy and devotees are a part of a warm community. So that community is not just for nurturing devotees. Community is also for welcoming new people. In fact, according to contemporary surveys of spirituality, of what makes people join a spiritual group. So that the philosophy of that group often comes like sixth or seventh in the list. What usually comes top in the list is a sense of belonging. Today's world, there's a lot of loneliness, a lot of fragmentation, even not just with joint family structure, even the nuclear family structure. So people want a sense of belonging. And that's why now how do we can't just tell devotees also be happy. So then that will lead to preaching. Actually, it is the responsibility of the community to ensure that people are happily engaged. So when I was maybe in 2017 or 18, I don't exactly remember. I was on my American tour. So I had been to Chicago. Maharaj very generously gave me a good amount of time. And then I went to LA. From there, I went to Carpinteria, where I met Giriraj Maharaj. I have edited several books for Giriraj Maharaj. And then we have a reason. Maharaj is also very kind to me, Giriraj Maharaj. So then Giriraj Maharaj told me, so tell me about your meeting with Radhanath Maharaj. What happened? And then I told him, this is what I was planning to do. I asked Maharaj about this. And then Giriraj Maharaj spoke something which it had not registered on me at that time. But when he spoke it, he says, in everything that Radhanath Maharaj spoke you, he says, I noticed that there is not a single instruction. There are only suggestions. So I was a little taken aback by that. So then I asked Giriraj, so are you saying that I'm not surrendered enough? That's why Maharaj didn't give me any instruction. He only gave suggestions. He said, no, that's not what I meant. He said, this is the way Maharaj generally functions. He doesn't give instructions. He only gives suggestions. So then I went back and looked at what Prabhupada did with life members. See, life members were not committed devotees. So Prabhupada, you don't see any instance of Prabhupada chastising life members or even instructing them. So Prabhupada's focus in general was encouraging and engaging. Now, of course, when we are committed to the service of the spiritual master, we will even take the suggestions and instructions. That is our service attitude, to our understanding. But In one sense, see, Maharaj may give an instruction, we may take it. But when we start instructing others, we may not have the adhikar to actually instruct others. So in one sense, Maharaj is modeling how we guide others, how we nurture others. It is not by instructing, do this, and then chastising. Why didn't you do this? It is by encouraging and engaging. Okay, what do you think about doing this? And yes, even if you feel a little diffident about engaging, if you don't feel confident, encourage, just try it out, see how it works. So this has been the overall mood of Maharaj in how he engages people. And in one sense, as the generations are changing, this is the way we need to nurture people. Maybe one generation before also, or even in my generation, we would obey our parents. But now it is like even the parent-child relationship is also not that vertical. So Maharaj's overall mood is encouraging and engaging. And in that way, devotees can be nurtured and they can grow. Now, this was a very striking experience for me. That is this, what does empowerment mean? Normally, we say devotees are empowered. Somebody is very empowered when they are doing successful things and they are doing wonderful things. So I was in one community and there were some devotees who were doing a lot of service. They were doing a lot for reaching out to Westerners. But what happened was that when I went to that temple, I talked with the temple leader. And the temple leader told me that these devotees, they had a lot of concerns and complaints about those devotees. Now, Maharaj no one knew those devotees. So then afterwards, I met Maharaj and talked with him. And Maharaj said, yes, I know those devotees very well. They're doing wonderful service. And I know the temple leaders also. Now, they're also very dedicated to Prabhupada's mission. But he said that they have a particular vision of how Prabhupada's, what preaching means. And it is difficult for them to accommodate those who don't fit in that vision. So then he told me something that we have many empowered devotees in our movement, but we don't have enough empowered leaders to engage empowered devotees. I said, Maharaj, what do you mean by that? So he said, empowered leaders are those who give space to empowered devotees to do wonderful things. Because what happens is sometimes somebody may be very empowered, but if somebody else is also empowered, I know empowerment can be at various levels. Empowerment can be somebody's very talented. Empowerment can be this has a lot of energy and zeal and vigor. Empowerment can also be, they have a lot of devotional dedication, maybe to their guru or maybe to a particular service. Say a particular temple is focusing on entirely on fundraising for a temple. And some devotee has a lot of dedication to book distribution. So then that may not fit in the temple vision, but that devotee can do phenomenal service. Somebody has a lot of dedication to studying Shastra and teaching Shastra and helping people develop taste in Shastra. But that may not fit in the temple's mission. So Maharaj said that, I have talked with these devotees also, and I'll talk with those leaders also. He said that if some the empowered leaders, they need to give space to the devotees who are empowered to do wonderful things. Now, of course, we don't want to have conflict with the local leadership. But he said that these devotees are doing wonderful things. I cannot discourage them. I cannot stop them from doing those things. They are doing wonderful things. So Prabhupada will be pleased with them. And Prabhupada will be pleased with the temple leaders also, because they're also doing valuable service. But this definition of empowerment, so this is a follow-up from the previous point. It is not so much of instructing and chastising as encouraging and engaging. That sometimes devotees may be inspired to serve in a particular way. And that way may be somewhat non-conventional. That may not be the way things are done. So if that is the way a particular devotee feels inspired to serve, then it is some leaders may think it is a failure that this person is not following my instruction. And they may take it as a personal failure. They may come down heavily on that person, or they may condemn that person in public. And then that leads to that person feeling rejected, brokenhearted, and that person goes away. In fact, this is what happened in many ways in the early days of our movement's post-Prabhupada phase. We see that many of the leaders of Gaudiya Math today are ex-ISKCON devotees. And not all, but many. Many of the leaders of ISKCON, of Gaudiya Math, are ex-ISKCON devotees. And many of them were very intelligent, very dedicated, very intellectual. But somehow, because they had a particular vision of serving Prabhupada and carrying on spreading Krishna consciousness that are slightly different from the leadership at that time, those devotees felt that they had no space in ISKCON. And they ended up going away from ISKCON, going to Gaudiya Math. So now, of course, they are in Gaudiya Math means also they are following Prabhupada, they are following ultimately Gaudiya Vaishnavism, and that is wonderful. But at the same time, why, if Prabhupada built a house in which the whole world can live, then can that house not have many different rooms in which different devotees can serve in different moods? And can we not provide them a certain level of space, their own room, where they can serve Krishna in their own way? So this was his definition of empowerment. So there are quite a few points, but I'll conclude with this point. So overall, Maharaj focused on caring for devotees. Now, Prabhupada sometimes used very graphic metaphors. So one time Prabhupada said, don't make me like Alexander. So what does Alexander mean? He says, Alexander conquered the world. But he started from Greece and he came to India. But when he decided he can't conquer India and go further. But when he went back, practically many of the areas where he had conquered, they had already been reconquered by other people. So he had to fight his way back. So he conquered one city, went to the next city, and by that time the previous city fell off. So Prabhupada said, don't do that. Don't let that happen to my movement. He says, I am here and devotees are inspired and devotees come in large numbers. But after I leave, don't let our centers fall in disrepair. Don't let devotees get discouraged and go away. So to some extent, we focus a lot on preaching to new people. And that is important in its own way. But what about the people who are already there? How much are we caring for them? Prabhupada himself said that it is now time for us to churn the milk. To churn the milk. But where were the processes for churning the milk? So who's actually doing that? So in many ways, when Maharaj built a community, his focus, as I said, was on caring for devotees. So there are various systems, the counselor system, the marriage board, the Bhaktivedanta hospital, the Varishtha Vaishnava Sabha for elders. So many, many initiatives were created for caring for devotees. And in that sense, that caring for devotees is the essence of community building. And now various other models have come up for, the names might be different, but that principle of caring for devotees is now become a very important part of our entire movement. So devotee care systems are more and more being encouraged and slowly being implemented. And we can safely say that Maharaj was a pioneer in this. So community building has been his distinct legacy. And now, of course, we have our God family spread all over the world. And each community will have its own mood. And everything may not be similar to what maybe Maharaj developed in a particular place. But Maharaj has also been very... So Maharaj has built one community in one place, but he's also encouraged devotees to be a part of the community wherever they are. So so there's one devotee from, I think it was Ireland. He said, Maharaj, it was somewhere in Europe. I'm not sure if it was Ireland. He said that, how can I please you? How can I please you? I hardly get to interact with you. I am not a part of your community. I don't have any counselor system where I am. So Maharaj said that three things broadly. And I've heard this said by many other devotees who are staying in a different place. So he said that be Krishna conscious, be happy, and work as much as possible in cooperation with the local community, the local leaders. So be Krishna conscious, be happy, and work in cooperation. So now it's interesting. I have asked different devotees the priority. So all of them more or less said the same thing. Now, I never asked Maharaj Vyasa if this is the priority, but broadly speaking, so if you see that ultimately Prabhupada, then be Krishna conscious, be happy. That is a reiteration of chant Hare Krishna and be happy, what Prabhupada said. So be Krishna conscious, be happy. And then yes, we all want to be a part of a community, but so don't be disruptive. If you can't work with them, don't be disruptive. But work as much as possible with the community. So we may not be a part of the community which Maharaj has created, but we can, understanding Maharaj's mood of service attitude, we can be a healthy part of the community, in a community wherever we are, in terms of our health, our all-round health, and all the health and the vibrancy of the community. And that is what has happened in many, many parts of the world, right from Australia to America to Canada to UK. Even in Africa, there are devotees inspired by Maharaj. And they may be, Maharaj may not be initiating devotees much from Africa, but there are devotees inspired by him. And they take the example, the principles, the emphasis on service attitude, the emphasis on caring for devotees, and in their own way, small communities are sprouting over there. So this is his legacy. And in many ways, we are all sheltered by that legacy. And we have the opportunity to share the shelter of that legacy with others in our own small capacities. So on Maharaj Vyas Puja, we all can pray that, you know, we develop some gratitude, more gratitude for not just what Krishna and Mahaprabhu and Prabhupada have given us, but what especially Maharaj has given us. And we can try to share those gifts according to our capacity. Zolnes Radhanath Swami Maharaj ki jai. So I'll quickly summarize. I know I'll yes. Little over time. So I spoke broadly on three main points today. First point I spoke was that how there are no precedents for building community, and that's why it is a big challenge. Because we had either full-time devotees or we had life members, and Prabhupada was never at one place long enough to build a community. That was a challenge. And personally, Maharaj also had no experience. But then for building a community, we talked about what did Maharaj do? So there was a shift from detachment to service attitude. Mm-hmm. And that ensures that there is greater, not judgmentality, but greater harmony between people wherever they are. And then from that, there is a service attitude, then and the next part of that was that we nurture devotees. Okay, we say we have to serve, but how do we nurture devotees? It is more not by instructing or chastising, but it's more by engaging and encouraging. Giving space for devotees to grow to serve in the way that they feel inspired to. And thus care for devotees and build a community. So community is a distinct legacy that Maharaj has provided in Prabhupada's mission. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Thank you so much, Prabhu. Such an amazing class. This really, it was eye-opener for me, especially on how Maharaj built communities in India. Like you said, he had daily programs. I didn't know that. Daily home programs in the 80s. So much learning for me here. And you advise so much nicely on Maharaj's instruction about caring. Very, very beautiful, bro. Wonderful class. Thank you so much. Madhavchandra, his guest is Madhavchandra Prabhu is here. Other devotees are here as well. So if there are any questions, please, questions, comments, please feel free to unmute yourself and share with His Grace Chaitanya Charan Prabhu. Madhavchandra Prabhu, you're there? You want to say something?
It's okay, I might be busy.
Okay, that's fine. Yeah. Any other devotees have any questions, comments for Prabhu?
Yeah, so Prabhuji, so one of the part of his community building is the what Maharaj has provided in terms of counselor-counselee system, which is because at certain point of time, that's the most scalable model, right? Maharaj instruction is given to the counselors and then they go to the counselee. So, so probably the question is that, is this a which is a, such a successful model, why not the other communities basically adapt that model of counselor, counselee or mentor, mentee, and you have somebody who is actively kind of nurturing your, how you are progressing on that devotion.
Okay. So, well, there are 2-3 things over there. That we could say that many devotees have an understandable hesitation to do something which Prabhupada has not explicitly instructed.
Mm.
So in that sense, the word either counselor system or your mentor-mentee system, you may not find those words in Prabhupada's books directly. Now, of course, Niranjan Maharaj has written the book on caring for Krishna's devotees, where he does give a lot of, you could say, references for the principle of caring for devotees. But still, the point that, are there any explicit instructions for this particular thing? Well, what happens is, Prabhupada's books are both, see, they are containing eternal truths, but they are also written at a particular time. So when Prabhupada was writing a book, he had a particular audience in mind. So Prabhupada, if you see, Prabhupada, nothing in his books talks about a place, about a situation where there are multiple spiritual masters within the same movement. So Prabhupada always refers to the spiritual master as singular. Follow the instruction of the spiritual master, the spiritual master. So the, in one sense, Prabhupada was addressing the situation of his disciples. At that time in our movement, there's only one spiritual master. And it's practically not possible to address all possible audiences at the same time. So Prabhupada gave essential truths that are universal. But Prabhupada also was addressing a specific audience. So at that time, our movement was in a formative stage. And at least in the initial years, which is in 1960, from up to 1969-70, Prabhupada actually was available for almost all devotees, because devotees are not that many in number. And in one sense, Prabhupada was their personal guide. And then after that, as the movement spread and Prabhupada started traveling extensively, it was mostly the local leaders who were guiding younger devotees. So in that sense, they were already the guides. So we could say that a decentralized system of care was there during Prabhupada's times also. But there is still a difference that there are Brahmanas and there are Kshatriyas. Now, we don't want to call any devotee by any particular varna, but we can look at the function that devotees are doing. So there are managers, and we could say there are cultivators. So if a temple president, the temple president has a particular priority, and that is they have to maintain the temple. Prabhupada could consider a disgrace if a very great disappointment and disgrace if a temple was ever closed. So the temple president's priority is going to be to ensure the temple moves on and flourishes. Now, a part of that is taking care of devotees, but taking care of devotees is also a separate service. It's also a distinct service. So do we need specific people for taking care of service, that service? If, say, for example, during Prabhupada's time, Prabhupada said basically for temple management, you can have a temple president and a treasurer. That is generally two things. Two people are enough, Prabhupada said. Now, many ISKCON temples are so big that two people are in no way enough. It's a whole body, and still we sometimes feel that it's not enough. So in some ways, we as a movement have had to adapt. that for functioning purposes. But because Prabhupada is not talking about directly about consular system, so to some extent there is hesitation. But I think overall it is being recognized. Devotee care is now is like a official ministry within the GBC. And now that means that the GBC itself recognized that all temples need to have some system of devotee care. Now, exactly how devotee care will be implemented, that may depend on the vision and the priority of particular leaders. So it's difficult for, if you look at Prabhupada's writings, Prabhupada often was extremely happy when devotees wrote a lot of books. Prabhupada was delighted when a new temple was built. Prabhupada was delighted when new people became devotees. What happens is, but we could say to the exact extent, Prabhupada would have been very sad, and Prabhupada was sad when devotees left the movement. So what happens is there are some like very visible markers of success. So doing something new, building a temple, distributing books, getting new people to come to bhakti, there is certain amount of achievement in it, the thrill in it. So that is what we are, our movement is focused on even after Prabhupada's departure. Once Bhakti Charu Maharaj was there for Radhanath Mahat Vyas Puja, and he visited for some time, and he had given an offering. He said that, Maharaj, you are demonstrating how to lead in the mode of goodness. Now, lead in the mode of goodness, what does that mean? So later I had met Bhakti Charu Maharaj. I was in Kolkata, Maharaj was there at that time. So Maharaj kindly invited, and then that is the only time I had like close association with Bhakti Charu Maharaj. But one of a few times actually. So that time Maharaj had invited us to 2-3 of us devotees. We had lunch with him. So I asked Maharaj, you have made this offering. So what do you mean by that? So he said that goodness is concerned with maintenance. Passion is concerned with expansion. So he says, when you are leading in the mood of goodness means you are focusing on maintaining devotees, taking care of devotees. So I would say that is in the early years, Prabhupada had to lay the groundwork for a global movement. So to some extent, even as all of Prabhupada's disciples were very young, and in youth, the Rajoguna is naturally there. So that Prabhupada channeled that in a very dramatically effective way by expanding the movement all over the world. So Prabhupada did what was essential at that time, but Prabhupada did give a vision about churning the milk. So I feel that this leading in the mode of goodness, where we focus on cultivating devotees, that is something which is gradually happening. And it will, as the need is recognized more and more, it will happen. That's what I can say broadly.
Okay. Thank you, Prabhuji. Thank you for your very elaborate answer. As I always feel that Maharaj, that system of counselor counsel is so successful. I just keep wondering why every congregation yatra should kind of have that kind of model. Thank you, Prabhuji. Thank you.
Thank you, Prabhu. Prabhuji, Vineet Prabhu has a question in the chat.
Okay, I saw that question. So, if we feel inspired to serve in a different way, we keep feeling we want to innovate as we serve, but leaders have a different vision. So, with limited time, what should we do? Yeah, that is a challenge. Broadly speaking, you see that there are two things. There is freedom and there are facilities. And in general, nobody will get both together. What do I mean by this? If you want freedom in the sense that this is the way I want to serve, well, yes, we can. Nobody is going to arrest us for trying to serve in a different way. ISKCON is not a policing movement like that. So if you want to serve in a particular way, we can serve. Nobody's stopping us. But in terms of facilities, now facilities could be something like, say if I want to do scientific preaching And then I say that, you know, I want a temple hall for a scientific program. They say, okay, no, we have a different program at that time. That may not be the priority of the temple. So facility could be in terms of temple's resources. Facility could also be in terms of the time of the temple leaders. Facility could also be in terms of the approval and encouragement of the temple leaders. So if we want freedom, we will not have facilities. It's generally difficult. And if we want facilities, we will have to curtail our freedom to some extent. Because the temple leaders, they are responsible for the facility that are there. And they will want to use those facilities in a particular way. So if we feel inspired to serve in a particular way, then we cannot demand freedom. We cannot seek freedom and demand facilities. That is unreasonable. So facilities can include not just physical infrastructural facilities, but it could also mean encouragement and appreciation. So generally, if we don't create a disruption, that means, okay, I want to serve in this way, but I don't have to criticize those who are serving in another way. So just because I'm serving in a different way doesn't mean that I have to criticize the management who is not doing that service. So if I don't do that, then over a period of time, our movement has become so big that different devotees can serve in different ways. And especially now with social media and online outreach, on the online world has, you could say, democratized outreach. Anybody can do anything and you cannot really regulate the social media so much. Even national governments can't regulate social media. What can ISKCON management actually regulate so much? So, but then if you want freedom, we cannot have facilities. So we can avoid creating disruption. So at least we should have some guidance, some blessings from some senior devotees, maybe not necessarily the temple management, but somebody else. And we try in some way to show the temple management that we are not rebellious, that we need our space, but maybe there are some occasions where we can show visible subordination. And maybe when they're giving class, go and attend the class or do something, maybe make some financial contribution, do something to show them, to assure them that we are not rebellious. We see there's a difference between being needing one space and being rebellious. Needing one space means, you know, okay, this is what is happening, but I want to do something else. Rebellious means that not that I need my space, it is people feel that I'm going to take over your space. So that rebellion means those who are in authority, we want to, they feel threatened by us or we want to overthrow them. So we can get our space without necessarily creating disruption. And then we can do it under senior guidance and we can have some ways in which we can have some visible subordination to the local temple also. So that way, if we are inspired to serve in a particular way and if we have limited time, then we can prioritize on our service, but then don't expect too many facilities. Okay. So, thank you very much for your association today.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Prabhuji, I have one question. I know you have been doing an amazing job publishing the Monks podcast. It's become very popular. It might be an ignorant question, but do you plan to have any podcast with our Maharaj? Or did you already have any? It'll be great to have you with Maharaj converse.
In fact, this is the topic, community building is the topic on which I have asked Maharaj. So Maharaj not yet responded. So I pray that Maharaj responds. It will be wonderful to hear from him directly. I have shared some understanding, but
that will be great, Prabhu.
Yes. But the thing is, Maharaj is, Maharaj has done some kind of podcast with Gaurang Prabhu, but they're more like about Yatra and other things.
Mm-hmm.
So I hope that we can do it soon.
Yes, we'll pray. Okay. Thank you so much, Prabhu. So if there are no more questions, let's all thank Prabhuji by loudly and enthusiastically chanting Hari Bol 3 times. And please unmute yourself.
Hari Bol!
Hari Bol! Hari Bol! Hari Bol! Hari Bol!
Hari Bol! And we pray that we get your personal darshan here in Seattle pretty soon, Prabhu, next year.
Look forward to coming soon.
Thank you very much. We were looking forward to have your association sometime soon.
Thank you. Jai Radhanath Swami Maharaj ki jai.
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 Hare Krishna.